Hello, everybody. Thank you for attending RSA webinar today. My name is Artur Kosakowski, and I will be running today's presentation together with my colleague Rafał Gawenda. The topic of this webinar is modeling based on AutoCAD data. In this webinar, we will focus on use of DXF and DWG files to create models in robot. The webinar will be the combination of a slide presentation and live use of robot, followed by Q&A session. As the microphones of the attendees are muted, please submit your questions using the question box of the GoToWebinar panel. In this webinar, we will cover how to use AutoCAD data to create models in robot, how to import DXF and DWG files, opening DXF files versus linking backgrounds, advantages and disadvantages, tips and tricks. There are two ways in which one can use DWG and DXF files for creation of models in a robot. If used as backgrounds, which is typical for buildings, there are just lines which are used for easy definition of walls, beams, or columns, and they aren't a part of the defined structure. When such files are opened directly, lines, polylines, and other objects defined create robot model themselves. The kinds of drawings which are most often used as backgrounds are plans of floors with outer boundaries of floors and positions of walls and columns, elevations showing locations of openings such as doors and windows, as well as plans of foundations, and the typical types of structure that are used for are buildings. You can indicate a DWG or DXF file you want to use as a background using file import DXF and DWG background commands, and then decide if it should be linked or become an integral part of the RTD file. If you mark the link checkbox, the file is read from the indicated location, and it doesn't increase the RTD file size, but you need to send it along with robot model if you want somebody else to see this background in the robot model. When importing a background, it is possible to decide on which layers to import, set units, decide on its orientation, horizontal or vertical, indicate the insertion point, and set the visibility range. To control these three parameters of imported background, you can use the object inspector. The import dialog for selected background can be invoked again to modify its original settings using object properties command available under the right mouse button in the same way as done, for example, a bar or a panel, or by clicking on one of these lines in the inspector. Backgrounds can be used for any structure type. However, the best choice is a building model type due to its unique plan view tab, which is the most efficient way of switching between display of backgrounds for each of the floors. This slide is intended to additionally illustrate why the building model type is the best choice for use of backgrounds. As you can see, in addition to the standard snapping points, there are some additional snapping features specific to backgrounds which are available only in the plan view of the building design. In addition, when the adjust to background is active, a robot can automatically detect the wall thickness and create corresponding panel thickness label based on the distance of the parallel lines representing the wall on the imported background. Okay, let me show the example how it works. So I will switch to robot. Being in the building type, I will try to open import a background. Okay, that's a DWG file with the plan of the story. And as I already mentioned during the slide presentation, we can first set the units, as you can see, Definitely that, not the meters. This background, this DWG file was created in millimeters. I will set the elevations, okay? My half floor is going to be at the 4 meters from the zero XY plane. Then I will rotate it and I press the apply button to see the changes. It's very useful to press the apply button before you actually insert the background so that you can see if it is positioned correctly. And then I can see some unwanted objects on that. So I will switch some of the layers, press the apply button again. Okay, that looks correct. It looks correct. So I can see the background. Now I can use this background to define the structure. But you can see all these grid lines, and I don't want to have them on the screen so that I avoid the situation when I accidentally snap to them. So in the display dialog, I'm going to go to the view and switch off these dots. That's the first thing. And okay, let's see. So, okay, the story level corresponds to the coordinate I entered. So we have 4 meters. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to define a wall. And I will switch adjust to background. And you can see that when I start modeling, first of all, I've got these additional snaps, the center lines of the wall, despite the fact these lines are not in the background. And you can see that automatically the software created the wall of the thickness that corresponds to the parallel lines of the background. If I define another wall, you can see now it is 20 centimeters instead of 25 centimeters. Okay, I will define a few more walls. Okay, so again, 25 millimeters. Then we have 20 centimeters thickness. Okay, couple more. Okay, this one, another one. Okay. Right, I'm not going to define all the walls. I mean, this is the same way of doing the operations, but instead I will insert a couple of columns. I will use RC columns. And contrary to the walls, you should predefine the size of the column. You can also, they will not automatically recognize the size of the column from the drawing, but you can just decide where to put that column. Okay, so depending on the position of the cursor, that will decide the center of the column. So I can put it like this, but I can also put it like adjacent to the wall, right? Rather than as previously in the sort of center of gravity of the column and wall. Okay, so let's put another one, for example, here. And we may put that one additional column over here. So how it looks like on the view? Well, we can see this is how the structure looks like. And what I'm going to do, I'm going to switch off the visibility of the background. Okay, so we'll just switch off the display. I no longer need it in the three-dimensional view. And I'm going to create next stories. So I will right mouse button click and then copy story. I will switch off this option so that, because I want all these defined elements to appear on the four subsequent stories, I will define two stories. Or maybe before that, let me cancel that. Actually, I will define a slab first. So, okay, shell solid defined slab. I can do this in the three-dimensional display following the contours of the wall. And then I will return to the definition of stories. Okay, copy story 2 times. Press the apply button. And I switch off the filter of the story, right? In this way, we can easily create the building with number of stories. And also you can define a different background for each of the stories located it at the different level. Right, and having a structure defined, we may assign meshing parameters, and then of course mesh the structure. Right. It's okay. I'm not going to calculate that model. I'm not going to apply the loads. And at this point, I would like to remind you about our two first webinars, which were designed to give you the information about the best way of modeling the structure and also the best way of handling issues with meshing. So you may want to actually watch the recording of those two first robot webinar. So let me return to the presentation. Direct import of model geometry from DXF or DWG files is typically used for structures with complex shapes, which are difficult to define directly in a robot, or for data transfer from other programs where there is no dedicated link to robot. Imported objects have no properties such as sections and materials, and those have to be assigned afterwards in robot after you imported the geometry. To import DWG or DXF models, use file open project commands and indicate the type of the file you want to open, being DWG or DXF respectively. During opening DWG or DXF file, you can decide on accuracy of shapes of arches and circles in the way shown on the currently displayed slide. In addition, this dialog allows to decide what types of objects should be created in robot. We can decide whether we want to have bar elements or surface elements or volumetric elements. The next opened window allows you to specify the insertion point, modify scale coefficient, which means that you can increase or decrease the dimensions of the size of the model. This is important because contrary to the backgrounds, you can't control units from this dialog. And finally, you may set the model orientation in the three-dimensional space by rotating it about the global coordinate system axis. So let me say that once again, as there is no units during the import, you need to make sure that the units set in job preferences in robot prior to opening DWG or DXF file actually correct are the same as the ones used for DWG and DXF file. DXF or DWG files can be used to import meshes created for objects with very complex shapes. The 3D faces recognized as surface elements can be then used for creation of already meshed panels in the way shown on this slide. As you know, we've got a lot of examples on our robot forum, and I would like to seize this opportunity to show you how useful this forum can be. So if I click on this link, that should bring us the topics on the robot forum, which is related to the slide that I was presenting. That's the situation when we want to import a very complex object with already defined mesh and transfer that into a valid robot model. So let me start a movie made by Rafał to show you how to deal with such situation. So the idea is that you have a model created in DWG file, and you want to the 3D faces in that DWG in this DWG file. So you open that in robot. Of course, we cannot easily define a single panel here, and also the objective is to have panels defined in such a way that their local Z axis are pointing either inwards or outwards. So what Rafał is trying to do, he tries to define panels based on the selection of 3D faces, which were imported and now are surface elements of panel mesh in robot. But we haven't got panel yet. So Rafał is trying to set the model in such a way that it is easy to select the group of elements that will correspond to the panel. Okay, so the first attempt is to try to see what will happen if we do it automatically. Okay, so he created a panel of the half of the base of that model. Now he removes the surface elements from the selection that belongs to this panel that were created. And he's focusing on the remaining surface elements that are not assigned to any panel yet. So again, you can see he navigates in the three-dimensional space and selects the part of the model, I mean the group of surface elements, and based on the selection using panel dialog, he creates another panel. As you can imagine, creating mesh in robot directly for such complex shape, I mean, defining a panel and meshing it, that would be really difficult. But having the option to create a panel on the imported surface elements list, that's much easier. So, okay, so the half of that arc, let's say, maybe that will be easier to see. Okay. And again, I would like to focus your attention on this dialogue, okay? So we can easily exclude the elements that are already assigned to the panels from the selection of all surface elements, so that when you open that in a new window, you only have those elements that are not assigned to the panel. That makes our generation of panels very easy. You do not have to worry that you will destroy what you have already done. So again, there is the attempt to select the half of the elements. I mean, as you can see, that's a bit of a challenge because the mesh that was imported from AutoCAD is not a perfect one. So the first attempt was to sort of select the right-hand side of this helmet, but Okay, it is actually easier to do it in the smaller parts. And again, the list of the surface elements that were selected. And okay, we have the panel defined on the half of this helmet. Then we select again all the elements, and we can exclude those that are already defined as belonging to panels. So you can see that what remains is going to be only half of this helmet. Yeah. So now we have the complete model. Okay, so let me return to the presentation. And actually, there is another interesting topic that on the robot forum that relates to our today's topic. And this time that's entirely a different approach. So we don't have 3D faces, we have only bar elements. And challenges to convert those sparse elements into a mesh and then have panels with those meshes. So if we go again to the robot forum, and we scroll down and have a look at another movie, you will see how this was done. So first of all, okay, this is the import of the .exe file, but as you can see that all these elements are imported as bars. So first of all, okay, we need to create panels. So the first step was, okay, create the panels. So the idea is that each of these square closed by bar elements will become a single panel. So that's the first step. We select all bars, okay? And what happens is we have a number of panels, I mean, between four elements. And now what we have to do is to generate the mesh in such a way that we have a single element for each of those panels. And in the meshing options, we force such mesh. So we do not allow the software the decision how the mesh should be generated. We sort of force all the settings so that we have only one single element generated for each of the panel. Okay. Now, what we can do, we can select those surface elements and create a larger panel. So instead of having like 10 panels, 10 small, 20 small panels for this triangular part of our plate, let's say, we will have only one panel with elements exactly as created or determined by the originally imported bar elements from the .exe file. So you can see. So we have surface elements generated. So we use those elements to create a panel, and we can get rid, I mean, replaced. We replaced all these small panels with one large panels having exactly the same mesh. Okay. Now, I would like to share a few tips and tricks, which I hope make the use of the backgrounds more effective. As we often mentioned, especially during the first and second webinar, do not overcomplicate the model. Avoid modeling small overhangs, offsets, etc. Make sure that actually the backgrounds, if there are more than one, are defined correctly. I mean that the lines are exactly in the same location so that you haven't got the walls shifted or shortened or longer among the stories. Try to switch off backgrounds that you do not need especially for a complex structure that may be a situation when you accidentally snap to the different object that you actually wanted to. And try to avoid having circles or ellipses on the backgrounds. And one thing to remember, there is no slab to the intersection of the background. So in this situation, you should to run the intersection of the DWG and DXF lines or polylines prior to using them as the background. Lastly, I like to encourage you to use those links to learn more or find solutions for the background problems or any other problems. As you can see, as I demonstrated, Robot Forum is really a great resource for information and solutions. Please feel free now to ask questions.
Thank you, Arthur, for the presentation. And there is a time now for asking questions. Please feel free to fill the questions in questions panel.
If I go to the, I mean, that's maybe not a good layout in the building. Let me start a new model. Okay. In the library structure, when you want to insert that, there is also the option whether you want to add this as an object or not. I mean, when you do not add that as an object, okay, let me do this, then you can select each of the element individually. If I delete that and I insert that again, as an object, then I can't select single element. I will select the entire group of elements. Of a library structure, then if I go to object properties, I can invoke that again and, for example, change some parameters. But I can't see any benefit of using that, importing DWG or opening DWG or DXF files. I hope this is what you wanted to hear. I hope that I managed to answer that question.
So another question, is the link to DWG updatable? For example, when the DWG file is updated, will it be updated in Robot?
That's a good question. I actually don't know. I would have to try, but I can't tell. I mean, I would probably, I mean, without checking, I can't tell. So, yeah, but I mean, on the other hand, I mean, if you already used the DWG to enter the, to define the geometry of the structure, I'm not sure if the update of that background will, that's similar to deleting that and opening again anyway. So in other words, if you update the background, what you entered in Robot will not be updated. So that part has to be done manually in Robot anyway, regardless if it is updated or just inserted again.
So another question, when we merge finite elements into one panel, can we remesh the panel?
Yes. I mean, if you create a panel in Robot, it is like the situation when you freeze a mesh, right? So let's say that you originally have a mesh imported from the other application, for example, AutoCAD, and you may say that that's sort of the frozen mesh. But the moment you create the panel on that selection, it becomes a standard robot panel. So you may delete the mesh and you may remesh the panel. I mean, my understanding is that the objective of importing meshes is that you actually want to have them as they are. I mean, otherwise, that would be easier to create a panel in robot from a scratch and mesh it. But anyway, if it is a need to adjust the meshes to other objects, you may remesh such panel. You may also manually divide some elements. That works. All the tools available for standard robot panels are available.
As there is no more questions in our question box, I would like to thank you, Artur, for the presentation.
Okay, so thank you all for attending the webinar, and I hope we will meet soon for another one, or we'll talk on the robot forum. Thank you.